Rand Paul has become just the most recent US politician to be embroiled in a scandal about their stock activity when we found out just yesterday that his wife bought stock in Gilead Sciences, which makes the antiviral drug known as remdesivir, which makes, it's used to treat COVID-19. I'm sure that you've heard about it. She bought back on February 26, 2020, before the threat from the coronavirus was fully understood by the public and before it was classified as a pandemic by the World Health Organization. So, of course, there is supposed to be disclosure of these stock purchases within a relatively constrained time of about a month. So that was February of last year. So I think that we've broken that. Yes, it's more than a month. In fact, it's a year and a half. But he just made a mistake, man. He thought that he had sent it in. And you know, probably the fact that he didn't report it probably had nothing to do with the fact that Purdue and Loeffler last year were embroiled in this scandal about the purchasing of coronavirus sensitive stocks. And there was this big investigation that seems to have been very damaging to them. And after all, both ended up losing their reelection bids in Georgia. But yeah, he was potentially privy to a sensitive information as a member of the Senate Health Committee. In January, they hosted Trump administration officials for a briefing on the coronavirus. I'm assuming that had no effect whatsoever. Anyway, we're gonna have a lot more details about what money might have been made, the actions that he took. But Ben, as I alluded to, this is just the most recent of any number of different instances where I think the public is right to worry that senators might be using the privileged information they have. What are your thoughts about this whole thing?
Yeah, most definitely. I mean, especially so to me, it's especially telling because it's investing in a company that makes an antiviral. Because antivirals are A, notoriously difficult to make, and B, also usually like if you have something like influenza, right, they won't even give you an antiviral because the time that it would take for the antiviral to really be effective, usually you've already got past the infection. So if you're at the point where you need an antiviral, you're already at the point where you're like, oh snap, this is gonna be like a big thing. And it's probably gonna be an infection that lasts like a week or two and take a decent chunk of time to recover from. And so an antiviral really is like when you've got like very serious infections, usually as a general rule, it's not always true. But in this case, I feel like it's pretty telling because COVID is a pretty significant infection that leads to, you know, like a couple weeks of being sick and potentially dying. And so to say, oh my goodness, this is something we might need an antiviral for, is particularly significant in my humble opinion.
Yeah, well, to believe, you know what, this might be a big thing. We should get some of this stock in February. Overall, how would you characterize the way that Rand Paul has talked about COVID? Is he talking about it as a thing that's so serious that we might need some sort of emergency antiviral?
Well, no, of course not. And this is what they keep running this game where, you know, they're literally not putting their money where their mouth is, right? They're getting vaccinated, they're being quiet about it. They're, you know, they're sheltering away in their mansions and they're like, oh, I'm not gonna go visit, you know, those random people and get myself infected. And then they turn around and get on TV, and when they're on Fox News from their Zoom conference, they're saying, oh, you know, don't worry, it's no big deal. And it's just this ridiculous lie where they're trying to gaslight people and say, you know, no, there is no war in Ba Sing Se, right? There's no pandemic, don't worry about it, you know, like it's nothing.
Yeah, and look, I don't personally believe that they should be able to own any individual stock at all. But at least if they were going to, having their corrupt privileged information lead to them purchasing stock in things that would pay off if we did well in the pandemic, theoretically bothers me less than investing in what we'll do well if we fail. Now, like if you random person watching this, if you purchase stuff like that, I get it, you don't have any control over the outcome. But he has been seemingly advocating for COVID for a year and a half. So if you also have a financial incentive for us to desperately need things when we fail, that really does bother me. But again, the overall issue is that they can buy individual stocks at all. And I know that some, you know, including Representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, they've tried to get this outlawed, but so far we're not there, Ben. I get why it's difficult to get people to stop themselves a path to making money. But I don't understand why so many people tolerate this, tolerate the personal ownership. Any final thoughts?
I mean, literally, imagine if he was like investing in funeral homes, right? Like, how grim would that be? Where it's like, oh, we're definitely not gonna do anything about this because look, think about how much money we could make with our funeral home investment here, you know? Yeah. Like, it's really that scale. And I think people really need to understand that that is the scale that it's at.
I agree.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.